Hey everyone, what's up and welcome to Young Tiny World. Today we're going to be dealing with some mental issues, mental health issues, like the stuff that keeps you up at night. We're going to be discussing it. These are mainly recent publications based on mental health and news that we all probably need to know, but I feel like the more you notice the levels of pain or chaos that's impacting our youth based on mental health, it will give you an idea of what needs to be done, or it gives you a sense of responsibility, if not a little bit just empathy, because sometimes I feel as if some people consider mental health issues as non-existent, as something that is not that big of a deal. And that's not true. So let's get right into it. So in the Solomon Times, it says mental health issues on the rise in the Solomon Islands. Let's just go through the highlights and then we go deep into it, okay? So first is yes, mental health issues on the rise in Solomon Islands. Second is Psychology Today, which says teens, screens, and mental health. So obviously they're going to talk about how many times teens look at their phones and why that is affecting their mental health. The Star also brings in opinion. Research has linked teens' mental health struggles to social media. One U.S. professor is issuing a call to action. Another publication in Psychology Today, Empowering Mental Health Through Inclusive Technology. Also, Gulf Today says mental health support programs for employees. And then we have for the spin-off, we have mental health apps are popular, but they have their limits. Then we also have Maricopa, schools prioritize mental health, among others. We'll see if there's enough time for us to go through all of them. But for the first one, which says mental health issues on the rise in Solomon Islands, let's see what that's about. So it is by Samson Saeed, and it's basically talking about suicide, which is also a very great concern in Solomon Islands, and it's estimated that the country has one of the highest suicide rates in the world, according to a report made by the WHO, World Health Organization. And the suicide rate in the Solomon Islands is 21.7 per 100,000 population, which is significantly higher than the global average of 10.5 per 100,000 population. So there are a lot of people are killing themselves. I really don't understand why they would want to kill themselves, but they always have merit. But in any case, the organizations in Solomon Islands are trying to provide counseling services and raise awareness towards mental health and work toward reducing the stigma associated with mental illness. Now, it's still a long way, but I'm hoping that they have a grasp on this entire suicide rate. I also would be curious to understand why they would resort to suicide, because they talked about depression, anxiety, and substance abuse are prevalent in the Solomon Islands, and many people are not receiving necessary treatment and support. Now, can't say that depression, anxiety, and substance abuse could be the only reasons why they would want to unalive themselves, but it seems quite serious. And honestly, there is no limit as to what a person might do in the case where they have mental issues. Not to look down on anyone, because I personally would be having suicidal thoughts every day. It's not something I'm proud of. It's not something to be, cocky about. It's definitely an issue. Sometimes I would joke about suicide at very unhealthy periods in time, even when I'm with my parents, and I start saying that you ain't gonna see me anymore because one day I'm gonna die. It's like boom, no one laughs, everyone just gets all grim on me, and that's not helpful. But yeah, for our next not so awkward news, It says teen screens and mental health. Let's see what that's about. But honestly, I don't think that we really understand the full extent of what these issues do to us. And sometimes it's either we overthink it or we don't think about it enough. Let's just go on to the next publication. Now, this one says teen screens and mental health. What's bad, what's good, and what you can do about it. And it says toxic social media is being blamed for increasing mental health problems in both teenagers and children. Social media can entice a young person into comparing themselves negatively with others and into inadvertent bullying behavior. When used wisely, social media and other technology can have many benefits for kids. Now, let's talk about this one after the other. It says toxic social media is being blamed for increasing mental health problems in children and teenagers. What do they mean by toxic social media? Now, if you don't know, it's cool. Toxic social media is basically when the post or whatever it is that is online is affecting you in a negative way. So let's say that they make a negative comment about a certain kind of food that you're not supposed to eat, or they make fun at certain kind of communities within society. It could be that they are a religious group, it could be that they're a different kind of gender group in the environment. It always becomes a basis for them to mock a jeer at them. That could be toxic in its own way. Now, another toxic way is when they give you a lifestyle that is insane and incomparable. It's like it's not even normal. There's no one on this earth who would be at parties from 9 to 5 and be okay or happy with their lives. They're gonna have a really dead liver and no happiness attached to it, but they give you those sort of superficial life vibes and make you think that you want it, but when you really don't, you're just looking for some form of excitement and it's not even the one that they're offering. But you see, human beings are more of a total, they're sort of a visual creature. Whatever they see captivates their eye, and you know, guys do that mostly more than girls, but you get my point, right? So the more you see them having their best life, you wish you had their best life, and you get depressed because you don't have it, and then you spiral out. Yeah, that makes absolute sense. And so that heightens you up. It makes you feel like you don't have enough and start chasing after things that don't matter. Your own mental health, you don't look at it anymore, and you just go after whatever it is you can to establish this life that doesn't give you happiness and just makes other people acknowledge you in public. You see, it's pointless. The next one, which says social media can entice a young person into comparing themselves negatively with others and into inadvertent bullying behavior. Now, bullying, as movies have described it, bullying is not like that. It's not like you would go to the school and then they would shove you into a locker room. Even though, yes, that was possible in the past. I don't know if that's what always happened in the high schools, but for us, bullying was when you would want to go out and play with your friends, but you never got the opportunity because they didn't like you. You would try to join them, but they would push you away, and they would sometimes hurt you because you tried to join into their, you know, daily matches or their daily games, and they would always ostracize you. They would make fun of you. They would pick on you. I mean, not pick on you like they take your pencils and pens and throw it down on the floor. But let's say that you borrowed something, all right? You borrowed something from them and you wanted to return it back, but they ignore you. And then they wait to the point where you've gone and missing, and then they start attacking you. It's like they have made up their minds to catch you off guard. And every time they catch you off guard, they hurt you a lot more than they would a person that they really consider their friend. So, yes, inadvertent bully behavior can happen in many ways, and it's not always the one who has less brains that bullies. Okay, sometimes it's even the guy who's considered a nerd who bullies, and it's not like with fists, but with the mind. where they would, do a lot of things that would go over your head, manipulate you, take you down, and make sure that you regret it. But you wouldn't know because they're definitely 10 steps ahead of you and they're teasing you every step of those ways. Okay. Last one, which says, when used wisely, social media and other technology can have many benefits. Now, maybe I'm saying it in a monotone, which is very boring, and obviously you can't keep up. But it's like on the flip side. The first two highlights of this publication were negative, but it's only the last one that's positive. The last one is just feeding into the idea that even though social media brings about like the chaos and the disruption that we're seeing today, from TikTok to Twitter to Instagram, there are a lot of good sides to it. There are inspirational messages, lifestyles that are very helpful, pieces of advice that can really help you go through your day. So it's not a total loss, but I feel as if it comes to the point where you're going to have to decide the right filter. Okay, you can't just keep going from one side to the other and expect things to work out for you, you know? You need, oh my God, there are freaking spiders in the air. Great, I got myself a couple of spy spiders who are trying to what keep my world safe. I'm pretty sure the mother hatched a lot of eggs. Awesome, great. Now I'm completely surrounded by a bunch of arachnids. Oh joy. Okay, let's go. It says Dove has recently released a compelling 3-minute video called Cost of Beauty, a Dove Story, which blames toxic social media for harming the mental health of 3 in 5 kids. It shows a young girl named Mary growing from toddlerhood to 12 years when she receives a smartphone as a birthday gift. As the sweet, playful child uses her phone, she becomes obsessed with her appearance and her weight. Well, to be honest with you, I kind of feel like even in a certain light, some societies really consider weight, like not even to sound racist or anything. There are some cultures that are okay with you being fat because in some way it signifies wealth, at least to them it does. But for others it's different. They want you to be thin. They want you to have a certain structure because they believe that the thinner you are, the more cultured, the more well-mannered you are. They associate weight with a lot of things, okay? So sometimes it's crazy and it's weird, okay? It's weird, but weight is something that is greatly debated, and even if social media wasn't there, weight would be a very integral part in selecting a mate, I can assure you. Okay, some would say they want those who have birthing hips, whatever that is, they want that too. So yeah, I guess for the story that came with Mary, it says over time, Mary becomes seriously ill and is hospitalized with what appears to be anorexia, which is, the thing that doesn't make you eat. It's really serious, Something that can actually make you hate food. That's crazy. There's keep it in perspective. Toxic social media is not the biggest problem. Now it says the goal of Dove's campaign is to support legislation compelling social media platforms to mitigate harm to children and adolescents. While that is an immensely worthwhile goal, it risks focusing our attention on a relatively small factor in the serious decline in adolescent mental health and thereby ignoring the larger factors. Now, you can't shift the entire blame of mental health issues to social media. Now, yes, social media has a part to play. Teens are spending a lot more times on their phones than they would outside. It's great, it's perfect. But you also tend to forget that there's also an environment they find themselves in. When they're not on their phones, there is a closest piece of themselves that is affected by the environment. And the environment If it's well nurturing, you don't have a problem. Okay, you don't have to worry about them being worse than they are. Social media gives its share of depression and anxiety and all sorts of unstable lifestyles that, they're trying to shove down the children's throats. But when the children are away from their phones, when social media is out of reach, there's an immediate environment that they're in that greatly affects them. And so that's what defines what they become. If that environment is the one that detoxifies them and makes them more invulnerable to the wiles of social media, they become more fortified. But when it breaks them down to their nearest and lowest form, you've got yourself a completely disheveled juvenile that is constantly going to seek validation from a source that is not trustworthy. And then you've got yourself more problems. Now, for most kids growing up in poverty, in crowded and dangerous conditions with poor educational opportunities and little access to mental health supports, toxic social media might push them over the top. It isn't the biggest reason for any problems they might have. And this is by Dan Keaton. Now, he argues that psychologists need to recognize the situation as a stress pandemic with many root causes and work not only to support kids in coping, but also reduce the terrible overload of stressors too many kids are dealing with. If we care about young people's mental health, we need to pay attention to the larger problems they are worried about, like social injustice, environmental degradation, and gun violence. Now, all these are valid. Social injustice can sometimes take a turn towards absurdity. I'd say that in the best possible conscience ever. Sometimes we overburden ourselves with light-hearted situations that don't really need council of elders to commune for. Some of those things are basic common sense. You want to deliberate over an issue that honestly would not bring you the kind of benefits that would an issue talking about gun violence, about environmental degradation. You want to talk about changing pronouns for your own sake. It's kind of a bit selfish, don't you think? Because if you are what you are, would you mind? Like, it shouldn't matter what I say. If I call you a word, that does not make you who you are. You are what you are, regardless of what I say about you. If you don't believe that, then maybe your identity is not one that you're supposed to have, don't you think? Because if your pronouns, you identify as something, you stand as an individual or a being who's got a thought process, who's immaculate, helpful, smart, funny, whatever you want to assign yourself as, you have an identity. And your identity is one that stands on your own. You don't need me to make you the villain or verify your existence. You are what you are. And it will reflect. If you see yourself as a person, I will see you as a person. I will acknowledge you as well. But if you don't, then seeking it from me is a little bit underhanded because I'm trying to mind my own business, not give you new life through what I say about you. At least that's what I'm thinking. Anyways, yes, environmental degradation is also a very, very serious issue, but it's rarely talked about because no one really likes to get into it. I feel as if after they have the charity funds or the charity parties or they have those GoFundMe projects that allows you to go plant trees in different countries, after they do all that, they feel good about themselves. But that's not what solves the problems. Those are just like PR moments where they get their companies to boost trust among the civilians in the country, more contractors to put their trust in the projects they're running. They're doing those things for their sake, not for the environment. In the end, they will abandon everything. They don't care about it. There is no particular sector or division that they've devoted into making the world a better place. No, they have a, what do you call it? They have a team set aside to focus on how to boost the brand company. And if it means planting a few trees to reach that goal, they don't mind doing it. And they don't mind doing it over and over again till they get the hang of it. Because trust me, that is what they have in mind. That is what they are going after. They're not going after you and whatever it is you have to offer them. No, they're going after the natural resources that they can control. And it makes me sad knowing that there are people who are actually defending it. They're backing them. These acts, these vicious acts, which causes people to die as a result of very bad management of these forestry resources, is just heartbreaking. It's heartbreaking because once you want to talk about it, it's always argued that it's being taken care of. Have you seen the statistic lately? Do you really think that after they send a bunch of people to go and donate to an orphanage or to go and help plant trees, that's it? The world is a better place? No, those trees need to keep on living. They don't need to be alive long enough for a picture to be taken and then thrown into the background or left to starve to death in the wild. I don't know if their like regiment of taking care of trees are just like consistent, or they're assuming that the rains are gonna fall and whatever that they put into the ground is gonna work, because it can be heartbreaking at times. And see, they don't know how to manage plants. I mean, if you did, then maybe you wouldn't just leave it in the ground and go ahead with your day, you know? But enough about this. Let's just continue. Now, we agreed that social media might not be the main reason why teenagers or adolescents are going through a hard time and have no way of remedying the problem. Now, the Dove campaign is founded in fact. Social media can entice a young person into over-focusing on their appearance and developing a negative self-image that leads to attitudes and practices that damage their mental health. Social media makes it almost impossible for teenagers to resist harmful comparisons to others' appearance, possessions, and activities, as well as popularity. Now, in early and middle adolescence, social media can override kids' judgment. Their brains are developing and they don't yet have the maturity to resist harmful peer influences. If a cruel post gets lots of likes, your child, who's normally kind and thoughtful, can join in, inadvertently participating in a bullying exercise that can have serious real-world consequences for the victim. Alternatively, they can find themselves in the innocent victim of negative online attention and be too embarrassed to talk about it. This can deteriorate in serious mental health concerns. So it comes down to what it is you consider as harmful, at least for your children, or for your family, for your brother or your sister, whoever is around you. You're not going to make any headway if you only decide to isolate social media. Now, social media, yes, is considered the poison of the youth. But rather than trying to antagonize it, maybe you should try and find a way to curb it, because as time goes on, social media is becoming irreplaceable. There is always a representation on one platform or the other, and everyone wants to have a voice nowadays. Everyone wants to be followed. Everyone wants to get in the spotlight too, because they feel like they deserve it. Maybe some of our generations are more obsessed with that, and some of our generations couldn't give a shit. But ideally, we have ourselves in these, how do I call them? E-environments, like these non-existent internet worlds right? People debate and argue about matters that are really existing in our world today, but I guess the catch is they have nothing to lose over there because it's non-existent. They can say whatever they want. There are no consequences when you say stuff on the internet. Unless you become famous, and then it comes back to bite you in the butt. But if it's just the person who randomly mentions something or puts a statement there that's inappropriate, it's always something that they can get away with. And that's what social media does. They give you a lot of power, but no consequences. And these consequences don't really, those consequences are almost non-existent as well. I guess it's safe to say that if you want to make a change, maybe try and figure out who your children are instead of thinking that they're fine with the movies that they're watching, with cartoons that they're watching, even the TV series that they're watching. I know, yes, it seems a bit of a stretch, but you don't really know your children until you know whatever kind of things that they watch, what they absorb. I was a kid. I was a really good kid. You know what? I got to know a porn when I was around 10. And it wasn't like it was shown to me and I was told to avoid it. No, I stumbled upon it myself. I got more curious and I found out more in ways that my parents never found out. And always seemed like it was a Mission Impossible situation where I'd have to be so smart and cunning in order to cover my tracks. If I'm assuming that didn't require a next level of intelligence, it just felt like to me other kids could do that. If other kids can do that, I mean, if I can do this, obviously other kids could do better than that. And those kids would be sitting in churches, they would be sitting at temples, and they would be reciting everything from head to toe. They would, every verse, they know it, every scripture, they memorized it, and they would still be next level rapists and perverts out there. And you would never know. The wolf in sheep's clothing, dude, it's probably a sheep that turned into a wolf. And it still gets to revert back into a sheep so that no one would be cautious around them. I always thought that the closer you are to the church, the more likely it was that you were saved. Hey guys, what's up? And welcome to Yonatown World. Today we're going to be talking about childhood and the duality or the deception of the Christian home. I'm a Christian. Yes, I believe in God. Yes, His Son did come to die for our sins. Yes, I do try to go to church every Sunday. But the faith they're waking, it's not like something that I was asked. It was something I was born into. If you were born into a Christian family, it's more likely that you just take it up and just roll with it. You have no say, you have no opinion. Even if you did find another religion that seemed more interesting, you wouldn't want to go against your parents. And that's what seems like it's good, right? I mean, you have a religion, you stick to it, and you follow it. But you know what? The reality of it is that most of the time, these kids that go to Sunday school, go to church, play the piano, are part of the choir, conduct Bible study. Those are just playing a role. It's like camouflage for them. The more they do it, the more they would look pleasing to the human eye. I always thought that if you were in part of the instrumentalist, you had a whole job to do with playing these instruments without fail, until I realized that they were actually just doing it to look cool in front of the girls. Like, some of them weren't learning how to play the drum to praise the Lord. They were doing it just so that they could pick up girls, because girls always loved a person who could play the piano, play the guitar, or play the drums. You know, like, chicks dig that. And because of that, they would throw themselves at the training and get it right because of that particular issue. I didn't know that. And I couldn't really wrap my mind around it, you know, because it always seemed to me like the church was a holy place, a place that could not be murdered or marred by anyone's evil intent. And then it just occurred to me that every single piece or every single activity that was taken care of by a human within that church could be thwarted into evil, like could be twisted into evil. And it just blew my mind. It just made me think that you're not holier if you're always at the church. If you're the person who cleans the place, it still doesn't mean anything. You could do something in the church and it has nothing to do with your spirituality. You could be the best preacher, singer in church, and it would have zero effect on your life. And why is that? I mean, I assume that the closer you are to God, the more likely it is for Him to like save you, right? But it still comes down to your heart. If you serve God, if you put down every single thing that you do and you're serving Him, if you open your heart to Him, that's when the possibility of you getting saved becomes a possibility. It seems possible that way. But people can be in the church and take whatever activity there as a chore. You know, come here, read the Bible, think of the smart things to say, and then spew it out. And at the end of the day, have a chat with Sister Lucy and go to her home and bang her. Use the knowledge that you have of the Bible to manipulate your way into the heart of ladies. Be their support, be their steadfast shepherd, and lay down pipe. That's what it is. That is the most. I never figured out that that could have been a way, because I always idolized those who were in charge of church activities like that. Like those who would be in charge of Bible study, those who would be in charge of singing, those who would be in charge of starting the entire service. I really looked up to them until I realized that it was all for show. That the church coming to is just like a peacock putting on its feathers just so that it can just come show off. I always never did understand. I always hated it when our family had to go to church and we didn't go there early. I hated how the sun would rise so high and that's the time that we'd be walking into the church. It's so hot and I just felt uncomfortable and whatever. Giddy up that they put me in. Whether it was a suit and tie, I just didn't like it. I always felt uncomfortable. But then you also have yourself in this setting where everyone's doing the same thing. They're coming late. And I thought coming late was we're so far away. No, it's not because we're so far away. When it's time for school, we're like the earliest people to set foot in the school. So how the hell weren't we able to do the same thing with church? And it occurred to me, yo, we're doing this so that we can strut our stuff, do slow-mo moves while everyone else is watching us. Display. Not doing it for God. Doing it so that other people would be like, oh my gosh, I love that top. Oh my gosh, those earrings are to die for. Where did you get that necklace? All of it, just vain. Absolutely vain. And so it makes you wonder, what exactly are we going to church for? Are we doing this so that people would be impressed, or are we doing it for God? I mean, the term Sunday best is there for a reason, right? When you're going to church, you dress to impress. Better. Better because you really present yourself before the Father in heaven. So what if you get the best attire, the best outfit, and your soul is as rotten as hell? Do you really think that that's what God wants? I never really understood it, because how could those who lead the youth be the same one who commits the sin? The same ones who drive all of this energy trying to make sense of every situation that surrounds them. Make over the top critiques and still be the one to go astray. It puzzled me that even the one closest to those who serve God, the ones who clean the very feet of the temple priest, is the one who is in the most sin. There is no line. I thought that there was a safe haven for those who are closer to the church, but it seems to me like that's non-existent as well. That's not a thing that happens. You're lying to yourself. It rather boils down to what kind of relationship that you have with God. Is the church just a show? Do you think that if you do more things at the church, God is going to instantly push away every hardship from your life? I think having a relationship with God is not supposed to be mechanical or automatic. You go to church, so inadvertently you become God's favorite child, or you clean a couple of chairs, and now you are the best son of all God's children. No. God loves us all. It's great. But he would love you more if you had a relationship with him. A moment where you talk to him, where you're not trying to impress him with vocabulary or trying to sound smart in front of everyone. You know why I think prayer can somehow be a little bit over the top is when you're supposed to pray for an entire congregation. You know what I used to do? I used to be a chaser of compliment. See, here's one. When it's time for Bible study is when we all share our ideas. Now, during Bible study, everyone would share a piece of what they understood when we read a passage. Now, obviously, there are no wrong answers, but there are answers that stir. There are answers that make the elders or those that we're having this discussion with, it makes them go look silent, and they start making these affirmative noises like, yes, true, amen, yeah. When I hear that shit, I'm over the moon. I feel so empowered to say more, even if I have no idea what I'm talking about. I don't, and sometimes it hurts. It's like a fix. It's like a way to confirm to yourself that you're on the right track. And I was obsessed with trying to hear that from my superiors or those that I usually have Bible studies with. And it crushes my soul because it made me think that no matter what I had in mind for a passage, I always had to tune it in a way that they would like it, not how I understood it. You know, the main purpose of Bible study is to become better. You know, it's to yourself in a situation where you understand the passage that is being read. So whatever it is that you were able to cook out of that Bible study, it's yours, and it's how you interpret it, and you get to share it with others, and you get to understand their POVs as well, so that you grow in your knowledge, right? But it's not the same with Bible study. They expect you to come up with a particular kind of lesson that should resonate all around the board. No differences, no changes. If you say anything contrary to what has been premeditated upon, it is assumed that you do not have the knowledge of God and God hasn't imparted wisdom upon you. And that is just bull. It's bull. And it's so painful when you give an opinion and they don't want it. They don't reference it. They don't talk about it. And I don't know, but it's so much more of an emotional burden. It's of an emotional stress that you cannot really quantify when people don't think that you're spiritual. It makes you feel left out, especially in a Christian setting. I don't know much about our fellow Muslims, but for a spiritual person, they always wanted to be the guy who's part of the prayer team. Always the guy who is standing in the middle of the, or standing in front of the congregation with his hands lifted into the air, and they're silent, and he's closed his eyes, looking so serious as almost as if an angel were descending from above, and he was the only one able to comprehend its beauty. That's what we thought a spiritual guy was. And that's what we were led to believe. Because the spiritual guy is obviously the one who can sing well, is obviously the one who can preach so good. Spiritual person. And it's true because if you go to the church, there are women, the women over there know who to go to if they have an issue. They don't go to just any deacon. No, they don't just go to any person to discuss their problems. They've pre-selected those that they consider as spiritual. But how did they know that? Did they have a chat with God? No, they did not have a chat with God. They looked at them whilst they were praying. They looked at them during one of those special events. They looked at them when they were having an online service, and they saw that one deacon in the back with his hands on the ground and his knees on the cold hard concrete. And that's when they thought to themselves, that is the holiest of holies. And I tell you this, it feels like that is all a sham. Church is always what is on the eyes, what people are seeing. You know, if you haven't gone out, if you haven't taken a soul, if someone cannot testify to the fact that you have gone out into the world and made disciples of men, it means nothing. So the eyes of man become where we get to validate everything. And since it has been like that for quite a long time, a lot of people try to demonstrate their righteousness or their spirituality when they're in front of deacons or pastors, whoever it is has authority within that church. Your calm and composed way of life is all just displayed in full view when you're at the church. Your benevolence, your kindness, your generosity is always shown to the max at the church because no one wants to show the dark side, the wrong side, the revengeful and the bitter person that is constantly at war with everyone and himself. It's the person that you hide every single time and you don't find peace. You know why? Because you are living a lie. The people who live the most lies are probably the ones in the church. Now, I know when you come to the church, you come there in hopes you be changed. So why do you turn it into a con artist playground? You want to change. You accepted the fact that you want to change, but you make no room for improvement. You question everything. You put it all in a bag, and then you steal it all. To be honest with you, being this way does not solve anyone's problems. You can hide your nature to a couple of people. You can make it seem like you are the most devoted kind of child this world has ever seen. But trust me on this, you are just doing this for men. You're just doing this so that people would call you out and say that you are a good Christian. You're just looking for ways for people to praise you. That's not how God's kingdom works. If you were really serious about helping out in the church, just know that that's not going to get you a ticket to congregate or to commune with God. You build your relationship with Him separately, and don't assume that your deeds in the church are a golden ticket for you to establish a communication with God. Because it can actually be a spiritual measure for yourself if you are working under His presence, and it can also just be an act that you can do because your time is all freed up. That's going to be everything for me. Usually I don't like to bring religion into this part of my world, but I feel as if we're getting the opportunity to address every and any kind of situation, it's probably best if we know all the sides to it, so it's cool. All right? So you guys take care. You're on time now. Thanks for listening.
Mom, Dad, I found cigarettes in Greg's jacket.
Greg, were you smoking cigarettes?
No, Dad.
Well, he's lying. There's no doubt about that. Greg, I'm afraid your punishment will be 4 hours in the snake pit. Maybe that'll give you some time to think about what you've done.
Oh, man!
That'll teach him.
And Jan, I'm afraid you've earned a day in the Chamber of Fire for tattling on your brother.
Smoking. How does a boy like that go so wrong?
Well, I live in a crummy neighborhood.
The Bradys?
Oh, hell yeah. They got robbers, thugs, drug dealers. All right, you name it.
You folks want some pancakes?
No, thank you. See, that's the worst we got is Jemima's witnesses.
It seems today that all you see is violence in movies and sex on TV.
But where are those good old-fashioned values on which we used to rely?
And cry.
He's a family guy.
Mom, my lips are too thin. Can I please get collagen injections?
Meg, you don't need to change the way you look. You know, most of the world's problems stem from poor self-image.
Excellent. The mind control device is nearing completion.
Stewie, I said no toys at the table.
Damn you, vile woman! You've impeded my work since the day I escaped from your wretched womb.
Oh, don't pout, honey. You know, when you were born, the doctor said you were the happiest looking baby he'd ever seen.
But of course, that was my victory day. The fruition of my deeply laid plans to escape from that cursed ovarian bastille. Return the device, woman.
No toys, Stewie.
Very well, then. Mark my words. When you least expect it, your uppance will come.
Mom, can I turn the heat up?
Oh, don't touch the thermostat, Meg. Your father gets upset.
Come on, this thing goes up to 90.
We touch the thermostat.
God, how does he always know?
Brain implant, Meg. Every father's got one. Tells you when the children are messing with the dial.
Hey, Peter, my thing went off. Your thermostat okay?
Yeah, it's all right.
Hey, is my kid over here?
Forget it. False alarm.
Whoa, ass ahoy. Hey, Peter, it's 7 o'clock and you've still got your pants on. What's the occasion?
He's going to a stag party.
Now, Lois, I work hard all week to provide for this family. I am the man of the house, and as the man, I order you to give me permission to go to this party.
Look, at least promise me you won't drink. Alcohol always leads